Welcome to Jeremy's IT Lab. This is a complete course for the CCNP ENCOR, Enterprise Core exam. In this video, we'll look at two more features from the STP toolkit, root guard and loop guard. Here's what we'll cover. We'll cover two more optional features from the STP toolkit. Root guard, which can be used to prevent switches from accepting a new root bridge on specific ports, and loop guard, which provides additional protection against layer 2 loops when a port stops receiving BPDUs. We'll cover what these tools do, how to configure them, and where to configure them in a LAN. Let's get started with root guard. This network is divided into two parts, a service provider network and a customer network. The service provider's switch 1 is the root bridge. Let's see how root guard can be used by the service provider to ensure that switch 1 remains the root. Root guard prevents a port from accepting superior BPDUs. If a root guard enabled port receives a superior BPDU, it will enter the root inconsistent state, effectively blocking it. This is a bit different from being air disabled, but the effect is the same. The port stops forwarding and receiving frames. The point of root guard is to maintain a consistent and stable STP topology by ensuring that the intended switch remains the root bridge. Under normal circumstances, BPDUs are forwarded from the service provider's switch 2 and switch 3 to the customer's switches, like this. BPDUs aren't forwarded from the customer to the service provider. However, if the customer changes switch 6's bridge priority to 0, plus 10 for the VLAN ID, I'm using VLAN 10 in this example, switch 6 would become the root bridge. That's because switch 6 has a lower MAC address. Switch 6's MAC starts with 5254.0000, and switch 1 starts with 5254.000D. So I changed switch 6's priority, and it declares itself the root bridge. Switch 4 and switch 5 forward switch 6's BPDUs toward the service provider network. And in the end, switches 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 have all accepted switch 6 as the root bridge. From the service provider's perspective, this is not a good situation. You don't want a customer's devices messing with the STP topology. Now I've returned the topology to the original state, with switch 1 as the root bridge. Let's try the same thing again, but this time with root guard enabled. Use spanning tree guard root in interface config mode to enable root guard on ports connected to the customer network. Switch 2 G02 and G03, and switch 3 G02 in this case. Note that root guard doesn't have a command to enable it by default from global config mode. That's because root guard should only be enabled on specific interfaces. If you enabled it on all interfaces would reject BPDUs, and STP wouldn't function. So I once again configured switch 6 as the root bridge. Switch 4 and switch 5 have accepted switch 6 as the root bridge. Notice their new root ports pointing toward switch 6. And they start forwarding switch 6's BPDUs towards switch 2 and switch 3. But this time, switch 2 and switch 3 don't accept the BPDUs. Instead, they disable their interfaces, thanks to root guard. Here's a log message on switch 3. Root guard blocking port G02 on VLAN 10. And in the output of show spanning tree, G02's status is BKN, and next to its type, it says root inc. BKN means broken. In this state, it's basically a blocking port. It won't forward or receive frames. And root inc means root inconsistent. This indicates that it was disabled by root guard. Next, let's return switch 6's priority to the default and see what happens. Okay, switch 6's priority is 32778 again. After changing switch 6's priority back to the default, switch 2 and switch 3 will wait for their port's max age timers to expire. They're still keeping the BPDU information that switch 4 and switch 5 forwarded to them, resulting in root guard blocking the ports. However, after the max age timer expires, their ports will automatically recover from the root inconsistent state. Now, the STP topology has returned to normal. Let's summarize root guard. Root guard can be used on specific ports to prevent them from accepting superior BPDUs. This helps to prevent an undesired switch from becoming the root bridge. Root guard should be enabled on ports connected to areas of the network where the root bridge should not be. For example, a service provider's connections to a customer network. Finally, be careful about using root guard. It can unintentionally block ports if configured on the wrong ports. For example, if you configure it on switch 2 G00 and switch 3 G00, their root ports, they will block those ports when receiving BPDUs from switch 1. So make sure you're careful about where you enable it, if you do. Now let's move on to loop guard. Loop guard prevents non-designated or root ports from becoming designated ports after they stop receiving BPDUs. However, its main use is on non-designated ports. The main purpose is to prevent unidirectional links from causing loops. As the name implies, a unidirectional link is a link that is functional in only one direction, likely due to a hardware failure. Let's look at an example. A hardware malfunction occurs on switch 2 G01, so it can't transmit frames, but can still receive frames. What are the STP implications of that? Switch 3 stops receiving BPDUs from switch 2, so after the max age timer expires, G01 will become a designated port, and will eventually move to the forwarding state. Once switch 3 G01 is in the forwarding state, there is a layer 2 loop between switch 1, switch 2, and switch 3. Loop guard would prevent this, by putting G01 in the loop inconsistent state, instead of allowing it to transition to forwarding. Note that loop guard also protects against software malfunctions that could prevent a switch from sending BPDUs. If switch 2 stops forwarding BPDUs to switch 3, the same loop occurs. In the next example, we'll simulate that by activating BPDU filter on switch 2. I've reset the topology now, so we can try it again with loop guard. To enable loop guard, use spanning tree guard loop in interface config mode. Or you can use spanning tree loop guard default to enable it on all ports by default. Now, here's an important point. Root guard and loop guard are mutually exclusive. If you enable loop guard on a root guard enabled port, root guard will be disabled, and vice versa. A port can only use one at a time. And if you enable loop guard by default, and then enable root guard on a specific port, loop guard will be disabled on the port. The reason for this is that they serve two very different purposes. Root guard blocks a port if it starts receiving superior BPDUs. Loop guard blocks a port if it stops receiving BPDUs. They don't synergize on the same port. Okay, let's finally try configuring loop guard. Generally, it should be enabled on non-designated ports. First, I enabled BPDU filter on switch 2 G01, so it stops sending BPDUs. And then I enabled loop guard on switch 3 G01. After G01's max age timer expired, this log message appeared. Loop guard blocking port G01 on VLAN 10. As with root guard, the port status becomes broken. It's in a loop inconsistent state. Like the root inconsistent state, this is different than air disable. Once the problem is gone, the port will immediately become functional again. To test that, I disabled BPDU filter on switch 2 G01, and then switch 3 unblocked G01. So that's loop guard. Here's what we covered in this video. We covered two more STP optional features. First was root guard, which is used to prevent switches from accepting a new root bridge on specific ports. It moves a port to the root inconsistent state if it receives a superior BPDU, instead of accepting the BPDU. However, it will unblock the port after ceasing to receive the BPDUs. Root guard should be enabled on ports connecting to switches out of your control. For example, if you are operating a service provider network, and your switches connect to customer switches. Root guard could also be used on distribution layer switches, to prevent an access layer switch from becoming the root bridge. Okay, next we covered loop guard. It provides additional protection against layer 2 loops when a port stops receiving BPDUs. Instead of becoming a designated port in the forwarding state, the port will enter the loop inconsistent state. Now, there is a trade-off to using loop guard. It prevents loops caused by unidirectional link failures, or software failures preventing a switch from sending BPDUs. That's the upside, but here's the downside. The port will not be able to transition to the forwarding state, even if doing so would be the correct action. If a switch stops receiving BPDUs on a port, the correct action might be to transition the port to the forwarding state. However, with loop guard enabled, that won't happen. Okay, let's move on to today's quiz. Here's quiz question 1. Which STP optional feature should be enabled on ports connected to end hosts to block the ports if a BPDU is received? Pause the video now to think about the answer. Okay, the answer is A, BPDU Guard. BPDU Guard is designed to immediately shut down a port if it receives any BPDUs. It should be used on ports connected to end hosts, and is often used in combination with portfast. Root Guard, on the other hand, is usually used on ports connected to other switches, and will only disable a port if it receives a superior BPDU. Okay, let's go to question 2. You issue the following commands on switch 1. Spanning tree loop guard default, and then on G01, spanning tree guard loop, and spanning tree guard root. Which feature or features are active on G01? Pause the video now to think about the answer. Okay, the answer is B, root guard. The first command enables loop guard on all interfaces, including G01. Then, spanning tree guard loop enables it directly on the interface as well. However, because the final command is spanning tree guard root, it overwrites the previous spanning tree guard loop command. And because root guard is active, the loop guard default command does not apply to G01. Only one can be active on an interface at once. The interface specific command takes precedence over the global default command. Okay, let's go to question 3. Examine the following output. What caused G01's broken status? Pause the video now to think about the answer. Okay, the answer is C. G01 stopped receiving BPDUs. G01 is in the loop inconsistent state, meaning it was disabled by loop guard. Loop guard will do this when the port stops receiving BPDUs. This protects against loops caused by a unidirectional link or a software failure that prevented the neighbor from sending BPDUs. However, D, a layer 2 loop occurred, isn't necessarily true. Just because loop guard disabled the port doesn't mean there was actually any risk of a layer 2 loop. That's the trade-off of loop guard. Sometimes, moving to the forwarding state is the correct answer after a port stops receiving BPDUs. Loop guard, however, takes the better safe than sorry approach and simply disables the port instead of allowing it to start forwarding frames. Okay, that's all for the quiz and this video. I hope it was helpful. Thanks for watching. Before finishing this video, let me thank my JCNP level channel members. To become a member, please click the join button under the video. Thanks to Jonathan Makra, Velva Jacob, George, Nasir Chowdhury, Gustavo Macedo, Marcel Lord, Pavel M, Drago Cirnea, Zakib Shah, Mayor Salman, Vitaus194, Chance Carter 56, Mark Jackson, Bold1C1U, Michael Carroll, Gerald Guillaume, Fristas1207, Gabriel Braga, Hector Hernandez, Roji Kuriakos, Arpad Konives, 5 Feet, Owad, Daniel Brown, Jose Alvarez, Hussein Yavuz, Samuel Tavares, Roger Bratseth, Mustafa Ersoy, Nasser Zahar, Brian Grant, Georgi Gemejev, Hypocrisy Allergic, Arlen Plagaria, Dear Diso, Adelson Pereira, Farad69, Joyce Njoroge, Lucien Stoichitoyu, Madmark50484, Alexandru Stratan, Hiago Bicalho, DMJ2, Kurt Nell, Omid Farakesh, Steve Cox, Jasper Yim, Wilmer Romero, Laurent Lam, Pedro Hartman, Ivano Capuano, Enigma G, Jefferson Steelflex, Alejandra Okana, Burl Campbell, Abhishek Sahu, Toxic, Sinan Sarisinar, Gio, Daniel Andrade, Jairo Francisco, Mike Crumby, Eliel Eliluli, Dragos George, Philip Jovanovich, Random User 7547, Wagner Botelho, ICT EDU Official, Mateusz Wzaszynski, Erin Gojecze, and Dean I. Sorry if I pronounce your name incorrectly, but thank you so much for your support. Thanks to you and my other supporters, I am able to make these videos and release them for free on YouTube, so I really appreciate the support. Another great way to support the channel is to like the video, leave a comment, subscribe, and most importantly, share this video with others. So, if this video was helpful, I'd appreciate it if you did any of those. Thanks for watching.